Welcome and thank you for joining the webinar. I'm Amanda Jadro, the Director of Portfolio Management at TRICOM. As an administrative and financial solutions provider to the staffing and consulting industry, it is our philosophy to be an active member of the staffing industry by staying abreast of the ever-changing marketplace. For that reason, TRICOM was pleased to launch the Industry Insider webinar series designed to share our expert knowledge and resources with our fellow staffing industry colleagues. One of our core values is to build relationships and become a leading resource to staffing and consulting firms nationwide. Our presenters today are Kurt Murray and Rachel Rododowski with Assurance. Assurance is among the largest and most awarded independent insurance brokerages in the USA. Top 50 broker, Assurance is a repeated national Best Places to Work winner. Assurance creates value by minimizing risk and maximizing health for 6,000 businesses and individuals across the country. The company is headquartered in Schaumburg, Illinois, with centralized offices located in Chicago, Illinois, and St. Louis, Missouri. Kurt is a principal at Assurance who provides insurance and risk management solutions to the staffing industry. With over 20 years of experience, his primary client responsibility is to provide cost-effective solutions and develop insurance programs that are individualized to the company's specific needs. He deems it necessary to fully understand a client and their specific needs in order to properly develop their risk management program. Through this approach, Kurt generates valuable personal relationships with his clients to secure their trust. Rachel is an account executive at Assurance who focuses on the staffing industry. Her main responsibility is to be a client's resource and trusted partner. She accomplishes this by staying up to date on industry trends and providing cost-effective coverage recommendations. With over 10 years of experience, Rachel educates clients on everything from workers' compensation class codes to loss trends. Throughout her tenure at Assurance, Rachel has serviced over 40 staffing accounts and continues to play an integral role in recommending risk management controls that help reduce claims costs. For the first time in over a decade, the limited liability insurance marketplace is hardening. The change has happened rapidly, and most staffing agencies have not taken the necessary steps to prepare their business for this sudden shift. Agencies are facing double-digit cost increases in their liability insurance premiums and dramatic and impactful reductions in liability insurance coverages. In today's Industry Insider webinar, staffing insurance professionals Kurt and Rachel will explain the reasons for this sudden change and what immediate steps you can take to prepare your business. By the end of the session, you'll understand the changes occurring in the liability insurance marketplace and know how to prepare your staffing agency for the insurance hard market. If you have questions during the presentation, please utilize the Q&A or chat features. After the presentation, there will be time for questions and an opportunity for you to give us your feedback on today's webinar by completing a short exit poll. With that, I will turn the floor over to Kurt and Rachel.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for taking the time to join us, and thank you for the introduction, Amanda. So what we're going to cover today, go through our agenda here.
Amanda, are you able to turn control over to us? Sorry.
You do have the controls. One second here. Let me take it back for 1 second, and then we'll switch back over to the other presenter or the other presentation.
Yes. Thank you. There we go. Now we're good.
Okay. Now you're back in control.
Very good.
All right, so what we're going to cover today is we're going to discuss the current state of the liability market. We're going to discuss the carrier's responses to the current market and let you know what you can expect. We'll review some staffing-specific examples of what we've seen on recent liability renewals, and most importantly, dive further into what you can do to protect your business and alleviate some of the increases and effects that we're seeing of the hard market. And we'll be reviewing contracts and indemnification provisions, analyzing the risk in your placements, discussing how to review and enhance your practices to not only better your company, but help with liability renewals, and what you can be doing post-claim in order to secure coverage for claims and take corrective actions going forward. So the current state of the market, so the insurance market cycles between hard and soft markets. A soft market is characterized by increased carrier capacity, which means that carriers are competing for business. That results in lower rates, underwriters being more flexible on their criteria and the exposures that they're willing to write, and they typically are offering broadened coverages. In a hard market, it's essentially the opposite. There's decreased carrier capacity, coverages are narrowed, and rates are generally increasing. Typically, the soft markets are much longer than the hard markets. The current soft market that we've seen until the recent hardening was about 8 years, and we expect a hard market to be about a fourth of that time frame, but it is difficult to get through, which is the purpose of our webinar today. So what leads to decreased capacity and higher rates? One factor is the increasing severity of losses. So not only are we seeing more claims, but more costly ones. This slide is a comparison of the top 50 U.S. verdicts, the average of those, over the past 4 years. So in 2014, the average was $27 million, and 4 years later in 2018, that's doubled to $54 million. So carriers are paying out more as those verdicts increase. Some recent headlines that support those larger verdicts, there was recently a $54 million jury award against a Colorado staffing agency. A $6 million auto claim against a light industrial agency that settled recently. In 2018, there were 5,700 California PAGA class action suits. So far in 2019, there have been 485 Illinois BIPA class action suits filed, and we are currently seeing a $9 million E&O claim pending against a light industrial staffing industry agency. And this here, it's a look at global insurance pricing changes from 2015 to 2019. You can see at the beginning of the slide, the blue, that would indicate a soft market where rates were at a decrease. And the turning point here was in the third quarter of 2017, where rates began steadily increasing and then pretty significantly increasing in the last couple of years. And as a result of the current market conditions overall, commercial auto liability rates have increased for 24 consecutive quarters. Quarter two of 2019 experienced accounts of all sizes receiving average increases of 5.2%, where in the last quarter of 2018, that average increase was 2.4%. And we've seen auto liability significantly impact the umbrella and excess market with reduced limits available and then higher retentions on those policies.
All right, so now we know some of the basics of why this is happening. What is the response in the marketplace? What are the insurance companies doing as a result of this? So we're seeing that there are adverse loss trends with both the frequency and severity of claims on the rise, which Rachel covered. Litigation trends and jury awards are really one of the major contributors to the state of the marketplace. The two earlier graphs show the doubling of the largest jury awards from 27 to 54 million, which is just outrageous. And one of those just recently this year that we reference is actually a judgment against the Colorado Staffing Agency on an auto liability loss for one of their salespeople who was involved in an accident that paralyzed somebody. So you think you're immune, and in a lot of cases you're not, because this was one of your own. So what happens when all of these happen in the marketplace? The insurance companies have what's called decreased capacity. So as the insurance companies take on poorer loss experience, they change their underwriting models and the way that they react by restricting the classifications, classes of business that they will work with. cutting out insurance coverages and reducing the limits available. So it's a trickle-down effect. And as we get deeper and deeper and deeper into the insurance cycles, and again, we're on a trend toward the hard market, the coverage restrictions and limitations of limits is going to become more severe over the next couple of years, even to the point where insurance companies will exit completely out of certain classes of business rather than because they've had poor loss experience in an entire group. As an industry, staffing is difficult to begin with considering the limited number of insurance companies that are in the marketplace. And as we get further into the smart hard market, we may lose, you know, one of the three or one of the four insurance companies, which is going to make it even a much more painful scenario for yourselves. One of the causes is decreasing the investment returns as well. Stock market has been decent over the last couple of years, especially since, you know, Trump came on. We've had a couple of blips here and there, but overall it's an upward trend. Insurance companies really don't invest their money aggressively. They're more in fixed income, and that marketplace has been really, really difficult because of the low interest rate environment. So they're not getting decent returns on their billions of dollars of portfolio. And those reductions in investment returns are, again, contributing to the lack of profits because insurance companies don't make money on pure underwriting, and that means pure underwriting is the profits they make on the revenue less expenses and claims paid. They actually make money, for the most part, on their investment gains. So as the investment gains decrease, the profitability decreases. What also drives this is insurance companies don't take unlimited risk. They have reinsurance treaties with other insurance companies. So even though, for example, insurance company is going to offer you $10 million worth of coverage, they don't assume the $10 million themselves. They layer it. So they may retain the first million or two, and then they buy reinsurance. The cost of reinsurance has been increasing very steadily over the last couple of years, which is contributing to your primary insurance companies having to raise their rates. And that's one of the major factors in the marketplace. So what do we see? We see price increases, restricted underwriting appetites. We have seen significant number of increases in non-renewals and conditional renewals. Conditional renewals where they are, again, restricting coverage or limiting their coverages, changing their coverage forms because what they found is that there's been a trend that they paid out claims unexpectedly for certain types of coverages, so they're now cutting back on those coverages and removing them altogether, making it difficult for certain staffing agencies that are in tough classes of business to write. So they're, regardless of whether or not you have losses, they may be non-renewing entire industries that you may be working with, for example, construction and medical and transportation-related staffing is becoming nearly impossible to find coverage for in some cases. You may have contracts that require you to have significantly high liability limits. For example, you know, we'll see contracts with $10 million or $20 million worth of general liability or professional liability or $2 million worth of crime coverage. The availability of those higher limits has become severely restricted or in some cases completely unavailable. So we used to be able to find higher limits in 24, 48 hours. For some of our customers, it's taken us sometimes 2 and 3 months to find $20 million or $30 million worth of coverage because of contractual requirements. So that is becoming much more difficult. The insurance companies are asking a lot more questions. So the scrutiny involved during the underwriting process has become much stricter. And we are having to spend a lot more time asking our clients for details and us answering questions and you answering questions related to why claims have happened in the past, what sort of corrective actions have been taken to eliminate or minimize the exposure going forward, answering a lot more detailed questions about what the operations are of the potential customer that you're working with. So those are all symptomatic of the underlying issues that surround the marketplace. But we're also, you know, what you can expect is going forward, with the lack of profitability, the insurance companies are going to be much, they're going to scrutinize the claim activity much more aggressively as well. So we can expect that there's going to be much more aggressive denials of claims going forward as you file these situations with your insurance companies. It's going to make life difficult. And, you know, you're not in the business of running an insurance company. You expect that if you have a legitimate claim, it's going to be turned in, it's going to be handled by the insurance company without incident, and just not the case these days. You need to change insurance carriers change insurance companies with somebody with a broader appetite, but it may be much more expensive. Or in some cases, you know, Rachel will walk you through an example here in a little bit. We've took one of our clients who had some adverse loss experience and was difficult placements. I think at some point we had two insurance companies insuring them, and we ended up with seven or eight on the renewal. So finding coverage is going to be much more difficult. When you have claims occurring, it's going to be much more difficult to get them covered. So, but there are things that you can do in order to protect yourself, and we're going to get into that in a little bit here.
All right, so we've really seen the hardening of the market for about the past 4 months. So starting with July 1st renewals approximately. So you may have experienced some of these examples yourself, or depending on your renewal date, it may be upcoming. But what we've seen on our staffing liability renewals is we have one staffing liability carrier imposing 10% mandatory rate increases, and that's regardless of loss history. So that would be on a clean account, and more so if there is loss activity. We've seen a staffing liability carrier revising their employment practices liability coverage form to restrict client coverage, which is extremely important in your industry. We've had a staffing liability carrier issuing non-renewals on all lines, again, even those loss-free, and resulting in, you know, what we've seen, a premium increase up to 200% and more restrictive coverages. We've seen significant umbrella liability premium increases for minimum exposure and high hazard placements. So drivers, for example, we had an account that previously did not have any driving positions. They went into their renewal with two driving positions, and just because the exposure existed, even though it was minimal, that doubled the increase of the umbrella liability premium since the auto was covered in the underlying schedule. Again, we've seen non-renewal on loss-free accounts solely based on exposure mix. So when providing the breakdown of types of placements, a slight increase in the construction or the heavier industrial, medical, the professional liability for medical, losses have been increasing there. So just that change in exposure has resulted in some non-renewals, even without losses. And we've gotten a lot of pushback when we're requesting a higher limit quote if it was not a result of a client contract. So just because of the nature of the environment right now, you wanted to increase your umbrella from 5 to 10, we've gotten some no on that, or, you know, we can offer 7, not 10, if there is an actual a client contract requirement requesting that higher limit. And this is the example that Kurt had alluded to earlier. This was a liability renewal for one of our staffing clients. They previously had the coverages there in the left-hand column with two carriers. You can see the limits and deductibles listed, and the annual premium was $51,000. They received a non-renewal from their current liability carrier due to losses, mostly concentrated on two of the lines, the crime and the employment practices, yet everything was non-renewed. They did not want to keep the lines that were clean even, they being the carrier, and the right-hand side is what had resulted from the renewal. So they went from $51,000 in annual premium to $214,000 in annual premium, and the limits and deductibles in red were either restrictions in coverage or increases in the deductible on the policies.
So now that we sufficiently scared you, which wasn't the case, it was more from an education and preparation perspective, let's talk about what you can do with your agency in order to protect yourself through this environment. From our experience, one of the largest issues the industry as a whole faces are the very one-sided contracts being forced on you by your customers, your direct customers or your MSPs. We are big fans of fighting those, at least fighting, maybe trying to, let's just say, restructuring them to make them more agreeable. We do hear from our customers that there's nothing that can be done, and we're of a different opinion. We think that there are things that can be done, and most of your customers in our MSPs are going to be reasonable at some level and allow some changes to be made in their contracts in order for the contracts to be more mutual and more balanced. And look, you're not going to win every battle, but our perspective, if you win 10% of the time, and when I say win, meaning making contractual modifications to make them more balanced, it's 10% less liability that you retain as an agency. You win half of them, you're limiting your risk by half of what it might have otherwise been because of poor contracts. So where are we going with contracts? You know, the world's obviously becoming more litigious. Saw that in some of the slides. Contracts are becoming much more complex. Used to be that the back of your purchase order with some general terms and agreements was sufficient for yourself and your customer. It isn't that way anymore. The larger the organization tends to generate larger contracts. You know, we've seen some that are going on 60 pages long between scopes of services and descriptions of what, you know, they require of you, indemnification provisions, insurance requirements, and attachment after attachment, and addendum after addendum. They're pretty complex. We do think as well that you should have your attorneys review all of your contracts before you sign them. So we work with a lot of attorneys to work in conjunction with them, because in some cases they don't understand the insurance aspects of the contract and what is covered and what is not covered via insurance and what you're assuming via liability. And obviously we don't understand all of the integral issues related to legal contractual terms. So it's important, I think, that you have your attorney and your insurance broker working on these issues jointly. Co-employment and the ever-changing environment related to co-employment in the various states and all the jurisdictional issues and really precedent-setting rulings that we've seen here, it's a constantly changing landscape. We're blurring the lines, you know, between the host employer and the staffing agency and the whole co-employment. That's becoming much more problematic for the industry. And then, I mentioned hesitancy to push back on unacceptable provisions. Don't be afraid to ask your customers to make modifications. And where we see the most success is when you do involve your insurance broker and or your legal consultant, because we can give you arguments, you know, such as, for example, why would you, you know, you're not your customer's insurance company. So you are providing them with a service, and that service is to provide them with qualified candidates for the positions that they need to fill. Your job is to not provide them with insurance for their uninsured liabilities. In a lot of cases, your customer, the obligations that they're trying to push back on you contractually, they already have insurance for them. And you don't need to provide them with insurance for the things that they're already insured for, and you shouldn't be insuring them for their uninsured liabilities. And we'll cover some of those here in a little bit. All right, so let's talk about a sample indemnification provision. And this one's moderately bad, but it's not nearly as bad as some of them that we've seen. So colors are kind of ugly, but they're kind of meant to highlight certain aspects of this. So let's go through it a little bit one at a time. Staffing company agrees to defend, indemnify, and hold harmless. So essentially you're saying that you are agreeing to provide insurance coverage for liabilities that you're assuming via the contract to your customer. Because of that cause, and you're holding them harmless for anything that they may do with qualifiers. Client and its respective successors and assigns, affiliated corporations, employees, and agents. Now, legally, I really don't know what a respective successor and assign is, but these words run on every contract. And I've asked attorneys this question. I've given this presentation with attorneys directly, and we all just kind of scratch our heads, and it's just kind of worked its way into the legal vernacular, and here it sits. From any and all liabilities, losses, damages, and claims, including workers' compensation claims, lawsuits, causes of action, and costs and expenses, including reasonable attorney's fees. Essentially, you're identifying them for everything. Now, that any and all language, it from our perspective, is unacceptable. You shouldn't be, for the most part, signing contracts where you're indemnifying your customers for anything and everything. And then here, it's essentially regardless of who's at fault. There should be some qualifiers in here. It can't be from against all liabilities resulting from those actions or resulting or losses, damages, resulting from your negligence, your gross negligence, your willful misconduct, your sole negligence. Those sorts of things are acceptable. But there's no limitation in this particular indemnification provision, and that needs to be changed. As an industry practice and as a best practice, you've got to have some modification of these indemnification provisions. Next, to the extent caused by the negligence or willful act of omissions of the staffing company, its agents, employees, and associated providers. That's cool. Would love to see that there's a reciprocal mutual indemnification provision saying something just of that similar nature, where they're indemnifying you for their negligence, you're indemnifying them for your negligence. Completely fine. Or arising out of the staffing company's failure to comply with the requirements of this agreement. There are some things that you are going to agree to in the terms and conditions, either scopes of services or other provisions of the contract that may or may not be covered by insurance. So this is essentially stating that you're agreeing to indemnify them for your failure to perform under all of the aspects of the agreement, some of which is insurable, some of which is not, some of which you will have coverage for, some of which you probably won't have coverage for and or adequate coverage for, because honestly, you can't afford to insure everything. We have no idea what your limits of coverage might be based upon what your maximum exposures are. I mean, who would have thought that a staffing agency in Colorado as a salesperson driving to and from customer sites would be stuck with a $54 million judgment? It seems kind of crazy, but it didn't even arise out of the nature of any of the placements. It was a salesperson. So, again, limitations in indemnification provisions and contracts is highly sought after. Some of the things that we're seeing in indemnification of contracts as well that are problematic for you and for us and for the industry is we're seeing clauses state that the client, your customer, has a right to choose defense counsel. There is no way your insurance company will agree to this. So you should not be signing a contract that has this provision in it, because it's something you cannot fulfill unless, of course, you don't report it to the insurance company and then pay for the settlement out of pocket. Two, settlement cannot be made without the client's authorization. Again, your customer will have no input into how your insurance company adjusts the claim. They do not have the right to consent to settlements. We're seeing indemnification for ACA, the Affordable Care Act, compliance and violations. That's mostly okay, assuming that you have the proper ACA coverage in place. MECs and MVPs or full major medical plans. The lack of the mutual indemnification is an issue, again, that we would love to see resolved and have that in most contracts. And then we do see the contracts pushing back on you the liability for your client's equipment and cargo. So our perspective and your perspective should be, why should you be indemnifying and providing insurance coverage to your customers for damage to their equipment by people who they are directing and controlling the activities of? Now, we do understand that if you provide them with a non-qualified candidate, that you should have some liability related to that because you didn't do your job at the staffing agency. But they're under their direction and control. They're driving and operating their equipment. So if their equipment is not properly maintained, it's not your problem. If they tell your employee to do something that is improper, it's not your problem. However, most of the contracts these days are requiring you to indemnify them for those various acts. And as we'll see, some things are insurable and some things aren't, and we'll get through that. So what we would like to see in contracts and indemnification provisions is that you're indemnifying them only to the extent of your negligence or willful intent. Do not indemnify your customers for their own negligence. And the lack of a mutual indemnification provision does that in a large part. Do not indemnify them for for any punitive, consequential, or incidental damages, because those are not insurable. Do not indemnify for lost profits. Again, uninsurable. Do not indemnify customers for liabilities that are not, that you globally are not insured for. So what are some additional of those? Taxes, interest, fines, and penalties are not insurable damages. Punitive damages are not insurable. So with the major court and jury awards that are being pushed through, the punitive damages issues is much more pervasive, and a lot of times the contracts are going to state specifically that you're indemnifying them for punitive damages. You're uninsured for that. Depending upon your insurance coverages, breach and use of customers' personal information and or confidential data may or may not be covered. It depends on your insurance company and the breadth of your coverages. Many damages that are not bodily injury or property damage related to third parties, such as financial and consequential damages, are not insured unless you carry certain types of insurance coverage. A breach of contract may or may not be insured depending upon your insurance company and the nature of the allegation against you. For the most part, as an industry, wage and hour related claims are going to be excluded. There was some availability of coverage under the employment practices liability policies for a number of years, and they were sublimited with large deductibles. However, because of the pervasiveness of claims in that arena, that coverage has largely disappeared from your industry. So anything, for example, failure to pay overtime or any violation of Fair Labor Standards Act or individual state or municipal acts is not going to be covered. Keep in mind on the wage and hour related claims, we want to see a carve out and a carve back of indemnification for the customer to indemnify you against their acts that cause you to be sued for wage and hour violations. For example, one of our clients is in the midst of a class action suit from a large employer in California who didn't provide the proper break time or lunch time to the employees that were our staffing agency's employees. Well, that customer of theirs got sued by the employees in a class action suit. Our client got sued, and now their customer tendered the defense of that class action suit to the staffing agency because they signed a bad contract. They signed a contract whereby they indemnified them for those very things. Our client, staffing agency, has no coverage for it because it's, again, commercially not available. And if it is, there's one insurance company out there that has a minimum premium of $100,000 with a $100,000 limit and a $100,000 deductible. So at that point, what's the point of buying the coverage? Other parts of the contract that you may or may not have insurance for, are failure to comply with your customer's code of conduct. We do see code of conduct complaints being levied against our clients. Failure to comply with customer dictated hiring procedures. Those are very, very prevalent in contracts these days related to background checks, drug screening, motor vehicle records if you have drivers. Depending upon what your insurance is and how the policies are structured, you may or may not have coverage for it. In a large part, we're finding that a lot of the agencies do not have coverage for those types of claims. So specifically to client coverages, the things that we're typically seeing requested by your customers are additional insured status, waivers of subrogation. They want client coverage under the employment practices liability, employment practices liability, and then there's client coverage and fourth party coverage on the client policy. So what we'll talk about is additional insured status. It's essentially providing liability coverage to your customer under certain circumstances. The additional insured status will exclude sole negligence on behalf of your customer. Almost all the forms do that. There's a couple out there that will, but the insurance industry generally doesn't like to do it. Fairly common that we see that. We prefer that it not exist in contracts because it's just extending your risk. Waivers of subrogation, kind of the same thing. If you're agreeing to waive your rights of subrogation against your customer, then you don't have the ability to pursue a recovery for claim even if the situation that arose that caused the claim was their fault. So again, we prefer to see those removed from the insurance requirements if at all possible. Usually not possible, but just be aware that they're there and what they're intended to do. Client coverage, be wary too, because a lot of the staffing or a lot of the employment practices liability forms under point three here provide what's called third-party coverage, but third-party coverage is not the same as client's coverage. So your employment practices liability policy must specifically state client coverage, and not all coverage forms are the same. So some will provide automatic coverage to your client, some will provide them under certain very specific conditions related to what the contracts state, some will provide defense and indemnification, and some will provide defense only. And if you're not discussing that, those various aspects with your broker, then you and having them provide you with explanations as to what is covered and what is not, then you don't truly understand what your risks are. And we do see a lot of people come to us and say, I didn't understand that this wasn't insured. And it's a fairly common issue with the industry. Beware of potentially declined coverages. We talked about that briefly, is that some of the policy forms do not actually provide full indemnification or indemnity coverage. They only provide defense only. So if there's a judgment against your client and your employee is the one that caused the incident to occur, you may be paying this judgment out of pocket, and that was never your intent. For the amount of money that you spend on insurance, it should be as broad and as encompassing as possible. Also note on the crime coverage, there's something called client coverage, and then there's this issue of fourth party coverage. There are situations such as consignment warehouses where if your employee were to steal something from the warehouse, it's not your customer that would suffer the loss, it's their customer that would suffer the loss. So it's considered to be fourth party, kind of. And some of the crime policies will cover that exposure and that risk, and some of them won't. And it's very, very difficult to find the specifics of what those coverages are unless you know exactly where to look. We see this also in the moving industry, where you've got your employees working for a moving company, potentially, who are moving other people's goods, and we find it a lot in the hospitality space, where employees are housekeepers and they have access to guest rooms. So those are just some of the common places that we do see that occur.
So to elaborate on just understanding your risks, we would ask that you analyze the risk in the types of placements that you're making. So review the positions, and ones that present the highest liability risks are drivers, equipment operators, machinery maintenance repair positions, healthcare professionals, IT placements and consultation, and other professional placements. So evaluate where those where you have those positions, and then evaluate the cost analysis of those. If they're going to make a significant increase to your premium, are those, do you have a large number of them? Are they one-offs, and are they profitable to your company when you're taking a look at the premium costs or the potential for uninsured losses within those placements? We also recommend reviewing your practices and seeing where any enhancements can be made to protect your company. So review your policies and procedures to identify where improvements can be made to minimize risk when it comes to your client selection criteria, employee screening criteria, employee training. If you do have drivers or equipment operators, are they receiving the appropriate training to minimize the exposure for losses? And also reviewing employee qualification criteria. So for example, MBRs, if you have forklift drivers, are they being run? Are they being refreshed to ensure that you have people qualified in those positions? And we'd also recommend to reduce your liability to uninsured losses where coverage restrictions are imposed, to, as Kurt mentioned, review and modify those identification provisions. And post-claim actions that you can take is thoroughly investigate your accident. So both from being able to make arguments for coverage when forms are narrow, as well as just helping mitigate the cost of the claims, if you can identify witnesses who may be able to help dispute a loss, and certainly timely reporting of losses. We're seeing a large number of denials right now on employment practices liability claims for failure to timely report the loss. So those need to be reported as soon as you have knowledge of a situation that could give rise to a claim. So even if it's just an email correspondence advising you of a situation, if it's an EEOC complaint, it needs to be submitted to the carrier at least to put them on notice, even if in the meantime you're just responding to the complaint and seeing where it goes, the carrier still needs to be notified immediately, or the claim could be denied solely for late reporting. Be prepared to enlist independent counsel if needed when there's a coverage dispute. We're seeing more and more denials. We have a certain staffing liability carrier that it just appears their first response on any claim is a denial, and then it's about overturning a denial. So more and more initial denials. And enlist the claims advocacy service of your broker to help fight claim denials and help interpret policy language. So be working with both your broker and an attorney to help find coverage and overturn denials on claims.
And a few other important things that you can do in order to prepare yourself to get through this next couple of years. We're a big fan of building insurance carrier loyalty where it makes sense. So we don't like to move our clients from insurance company to insurance company to insurance company year after year after year to save 5%. We prefer to leave them in a relationship long term, so the insurance company has essentially a bank of profitability built up for when something goes wrong and when they have a large claim. And it becomes more and more important today when insurance companies get very trigger happy on non-renewing clients that have even marginal profitability. They want the cream of the crop at this point. And if you're giving them losses, even if they're small, but they're frequent, they're going to be inclined to non-renew. But if you've got a five-year history, a 10-year history with them, and they've developed a bank of profitability, you're going to be in a much better place to negotiate renewals. Be prepared for your broker to ask you a lot more detail about your placements, the nature of your business, operational controls, because we find that we get better results when we provide more detail to the underwriters in markets like this. The insurance companies are going to be asking us a lot more detail about you because they're documenting their underwriting files much more aggressively and with much more detail than they have up until really in the last 10 years. With shrinking capacity in the marketplace, the insurance companies are going to actually start limiting the number of brokers that they work with. So they're going to be searching out those brokers that are able to provide them with good prospects and with good opportunities. So there's a real strong chance that insurance companies are going to say, we're not going to work with 3,000 brokers anymore, 2,000, we're going to work with 30, or we're going to go from 50 down to 10, and only those strongest broker relationships that have the scope of knowledge and the breadth of knowledge and the scope of relationships in the industry are going to be the preferred ways for the insurance companies to do business. Communicate any potential coverage needs as soon as possible with your broker because, as I mentioned earlier, it's going to be much more difficult for us to find coverage going forward, whether it be new coverages, changes in coverages, meaning you, for example, you needed to add client coverage to your crime policy because of a contractual relationship, or you need a liability limit that went from $10 million to $20 million, it's going to take us more time. And we know that time is of the essence with you and your customers because you get an opportunity to go see somebody on Wednesday, they may need people on Friday, and it may not be as easy any longer for us to draft an email to an insurance company and respond back, and they respond back in 3 hours with a quote. It could take days, weeks, or even months in some cases. Be aware of minimum earned premiums on policies. The example that Rachel showed you earlier, where one of our clients went from roughly $50,000 to $200,000 in premium, a lot of those insurance policies have 25% minimum earned premiums. Because in that particular case, we were actually able to remarket that account and get the premiums cut about in half, ultimately from that worst case scenario, but we had to wait 3 months because a lot of the policies had 25% minimum earned premiums. requirements, don't try to avoid 100% or 50% minimum earned policy, minimum earned premium policies, because those do exist in the marketplace and there's quite a few of them. So even if you were to cancel those policies 2 days into a new policy year, you're still on the hook for 100% of the premium. So keep the minimum earned premiums on policies as low as possible. And I think with that, yeah, we'll open it up for questions. Amanda, did you get any questions during the session so far? Or if anybody has anything, just use the chat feature.
Yes, go ahead and use the chat feature or the Q&A if you'd like to submit any questions. We have both Rachel and Kurt available to kind of field questions that you may have after today's presentation. While people are thinking of, you know, kind of what things they may want to ask, is there any takeaways that you would like or final thoughts that you would like to share with the team to kind of provoke some thought?
Yeah, so it's our general perception that hard markets such as this don't last very long. The soft markets tend to last longer, but what we see is there is an extreme overreaction to market conditions. So hard markets tend to be severe, short-term but sharp. Soft markets tend to be longer but much more gradual. So the rates go up really fast and they come down very slowly. So I would suspect, and we expect, that there this to be a 2 to 3 year cycle, but premiums may go up in total 50 to 70% over the course of those couple of years in general, and it'll take 6 years for them to come back down to where they've been today. But there are, like I said, there are ways to protect yourself and mitigate the impacts of a market such as this. And generally, too, the workers' comp, I'll mention that real quick, the workers' comp marketplace right now is still considered soft or flat, but we would expect to see some hardening of the workers' comp marketplace over the next 2 years as well, because we think that one's next. That's the next one that's right. And there's a whole, that's another hour-long discussion about what you can and can't do, what you can and should do to protect yourself from a hardening workers' comp marketplace, because it's similar, but a lot of things are different.
Thank you for sharing that. And for anyone who wants to take their questions offline or to get additional information, you can reach both Rachel and Kurt by email or by phone. Both of their contact information is up on the screen now, so feel free to do that as well. I will open up a poll in the meantime. Again, just some other contact information. Doesn't look like we have any other questions that have come in. So with that, unless Rachel, you have any final thoughts to share, we can wrap the session up for today.
No, that sounds good, and feel free to reach out with any questions.
Yeah, thanks, Amanda. Thanks. So, we appreciate the invitation to talk.
Perfect. So again, I'd just like to thank everyone for joining us in today's webinar, and Kurt and Rachel for sharing your knowledge of preparing for the staffing agency's insurance hard market. Thank you again for your participation, and watch for information on our next webinar session. And if you have any additional questions or like some insurance information, please feel free to reach out to Rachel and Kurt directly. Have a great day, everyone.
Thanks.